Okay, thank you, Chair, for that wonderful introduction. It's good to be here, and just to follow up on what Ms. Blake said, I just came back from Mexico representing Trinidad and Tobago at the UNGGIM Americas, and there's a lot of progress being made at the international level and at the regional and national levels. I want to add that the UE is very much part of the project that is funded by the government of Mexico, and that we have benefited significantly from that. And one of the things that we are benefiting from is that Trinidad and Tobago and UE San Agustin will be hosting the repository of all spatial data, all satellite imagery for the ACS countries, the Association of Caribbean State Countries that are participating in this project. And we at UE are going to make all that data openly available to everyone. So just, you know, so that you know that that is happening and that is going to come very soon. However, this morning I'm here to talk about the NSDI, and my talk will give a little background just so you know what NSDI is about, the NSDI Council of Trinidad and Tobago, what we've done so far, some outstanding issues, our present status. You know that we've had a recent change in government and that has impacted somewhat on the status of the council, so I'll talk a little bit about that, some prospects, and just some concluding remarks. So, just to be, you know, I'm an academic, so I have to provide some definitions for you with respect to what an NSDI is. And a lot of you will know this, you would have seen this before, but just to make sure that we are clear on what we are talking about, we define an NSDI as the technologies, policies, and people, and you notice that the people here is very prominent, necessary to promote the sharing of spatial data throughout all levels of government, the private and non-profit sectors, and the academic community. And I take the part with private and non-profit sectors very seriously, because it's not only about dealing with in government, all government organizations. We have to be very mindful that the real engine of progress comes a lot of time from the private sector. And as Ms. Blake said, it's very important to have that partnership, and I subscribe to that. So, in terms of the overall structure, this is what we intended when we decided that we were going to set up our NSDI. We had to deal with fundamental data sets. There's some base data that we must have, for example, satellite imagery, aerial photography, roads, buildings, postal codes, and so on. That's your fundamental data sets. And then you have to have thematic data, which would be things like socioeconomic data, other types of data that we can use and integrate into our NSDI. Of course, we need metadata as well, and that is data about the data documentation. We need to know when the data was collected, who collected it, and so on, so that we could be sure about how much trust we can place on our data. The interesting thing is that out of the Mexican project, we did an evaluation of metadata in the Caribbean region. You know how much metadata Trinidad and Tobago had? Anybody want to take a guess? 0%. We had none. And that's a reflection of how little attention we pay to making sure that we know what reliability, what quality our data is at any point in time. So we haven't done that. And therefore, we couldn't create a clearinghouse, a catalog of what data exists. So we need to have that. We need to use our communications network to share our data. Of course, we need a legal framework, and we are yet to have one of those in Trinidad and Tobago. The Bahamas has it. Belize is actually working towards legislation as well. And of course, we need an information policy on how we're going to share data. Wrapped around all of that would be standards. And whether it's metadata standards, data quality standards, other standards, we need to make sure we have standards as well. So that's the overall goal. When we talk about setting up NSDI, we need to make sure that we have all of that. And on the top of it, we have inter-institutional leadership. And that's very important, because if there isn't buy-in across the board, it is not likely to happen. And you'll see how we went about doing that. I don't think I need to say this, just to say that we absolutely need to share data. GIS data, spatial data, is a national asset. It belongs to all of us. And the only way we could benefit from it is if we share it. There's no point hoarding it. There's no point keeping it for yourself. The more we use data, the more useful it becomes, and the more value for money we get out of it. And that's one of the most important fundamental philosophy that one must have if you're moving towards NSDI. So, 2 years ago, I reported to the NSDI. We had an NSDI committee, and we were working towards setting up an NSDI council. The council itself was established by cabinet minute, on August 14th, 2014. So we've been around for just over a year. We prepared a status report as well as an establishment plan, and cabinet approved it. And just to note, so that I think Ms. Blake would be pleased to hear this, the establishment plan was presented at the UNGGM America's committee meeting in New York in August. And the Open Geospatial Consortium, the people responsible for doing a lot of standards, geospatial standards, asked for a copy of it. And so I sent a copy to the vice president of OGC, who looked at it and shared it with the president and other people in OGC. And they came back to us and said it was the most impressive NSDI establishment plan they have seen anywhere in the world. That it was the most comprehensive, and they were very pleased because in it we had draft legislation and we had job specs, job specification for every single member of staff that were to be hired by the council. They were blown away. And in fact, I was in Mexico, and on Thursday, the vice president of OGC said to me that he would like to get permission to place this so that it becomes an international best practice on how NSDI should be set up. Just so that you know that we are not too backward when it comes to doing good work. All right, and I was very pleased with that. So, what was the mandate of the NSDI Council? It was established, we were supposed to appoint an executive director and other members of the management team. We were to acquire hardware and software and other resources and hire all the other employees. We were mandated to develop national standards and policies for spatial data. We were mandated as well to do a user requirements analysis for all the stakeholder agencies that will be part of the SDI, and develop and host fundamental data sets for Trinidad and Tobago. In addition, we were to facilitate signing of MOUs amongst all the agencies participating in NSDI. What is interesting, though, is that this was only interim until we enacted legislation. Fortunately, the Minister of Lands and the Land Management Division was able to sign 56 MOUs for all, you know, with different government agencies to share data. So we felt that we already had a lot of that done, so we didn't push to do that. Draft legislation, of course, to conceptualize a research and innovation center to support the work of the council. And I will talk a little bit about that as we go along, and to identify all the agencies that need to be connected using reliable fiber optic to the NSDI clearinghouse that was to be created. This is the organizational structure of the NSDI Council as accepted by Cabinet. Board of Directors would report to the Ministry of Planning, who will then report to Cabinet. We would have executive management made up of someone, a director of administration, a director of standards and policy, capacity building, and a spatial data center. And under that, we'll have various personnel to deal with various issues, as shown here. The board of directors, and it's one of the largest boards you could find in Trinidad and Tobago, and there was a reason for this. Most of the members of the board were ex officio members, meaning that they were there because of the position they held. So the director of surveys, the commissioner of state lands, the director of land administration division, director of town country plan division, commissioner of valuation, registrar general, and so on. And you notice what we did. These are the people who would be the data generators. These are the people who would be the custodians of a lot of data, authoritative data for Trinidad and Tobago. So we wanted the heavy hitters who were involved in geospatial information. And in fact, all of these people agreed to serve on the board. All of us were appointed November last year. I happened to be chair of the board of directors up to recently. And I'll mention what happened as we go along. We were able, in terms of progress, we were able to secure office space at the Sterling building where the Mercedes dealership is. And this was outfitted with all the computers. We had 56 spaces with computers, we had servers, conference room facilities, and all the other requirements that, the council needed. We advertised, received, and reviewed applications for the positions of executive director, administrative director, and spatial analyst. We were a week away from interviews when the elections happened. We already initiated discussions with iGovTT, and they actually reserved 24 spaces for servers on their survey racks at the, iGov data center to store spatial data for us. We had initiated a discussion with Esri for an enterprise license agreement to acquire Esri for the entire software for the entire government of Trinidad and Tobago. We had to put that on hold. By the way, Jamaica signed an enterprise license agreement for 4 years at just about a cost of $2.3 million, just about. And we completed the initial draft legislation to establish the council. So that is some of the progress we made. We already had developed all the policies that are required for the council to run. Operations policies, procurement policies, everything else with respect to how an organization should run. We started work on the fundamental data sets. We started doing awareness presentations to several government agencies. We actually represented government of Trinidad and Tobago at the UN DGIM meeting in New York last August that Ms. Blake mentioned. So we, the council was the official delegate to go to UN DGIM. And we initiated discussions already with UWE to establish the Research and Innovation Center. And that is something that is ongoing as we speak. Some of the issues at present, we unfortunately do have a management team as yet. We haven't done the national standards and policies as yet. We didn't do the user requirements analysis. And we haven't gotten to the point where we could host the fundamental data sets. Present status. Unfortunately, the entire board was requested to resign at the end of September. So at this stage, the work is at a standstill. The board is yet to be, a new board is yet to be put in place. As far as I'm aware, the Ministry of, Planning is preparing a cabinet note to reappoint the previous board, you know, and block the entire previous board is going to be reappointed. Hopefully, if Cabinet accepts it, we'll see what happens. There are funds already allocated from the new national budget that was approved last month, so we have money for that as well. So we'll see what happens. In terms of prospects, notwithstanding what happens, the government has two options. They could say, all right, look, we don't think this council makes sense, and they could do away with it. Or they can appoint the new board, and then the work of the council can continue. I have no idea what will happen. So this is my own view, my own opinion on where we should be going. The fundamental data sets are being compiled anyway. The Lands and Surveys Division has done excellent work to fly photography at 12.5 centimeter resolution color. That is going to be available soon. They have flown LIDAR, which is going to be ready soon. The TT Post is making progress with their national addressing system. Other things are going to be happening, and therefore the fundamental data sets will be compiled, you know, with or without the council. Another thing that is happening at the international level, and I don't think Cecile mentioned this, is this whole open government partnership. And more countries are subscribing to making sure that their governments are open and more transparent, and they're providing various information as a result of that. Another thing that's happening is this whole open government data agenda that is being pushed again. World Bank and other people are pushing this in a very significant way to make sure that data becomes open across countries, across the world. And we have subscribed, we are one of the signatories to that, so that I know government of Trinidad and Tobago is moving towards that. Of course, there are, as Cecile mentioned, UNGGIM, and we are very much part of that. And Trinidad and Tobago, you know, is a member state of the UN, and we subscribe to working on the Sustainable Development Goals, and of course we need data for that. So there are prospects with respect to how we can move that forward. I believe, though, that the GIS Society and the UE can provide a lot of support. And based on the objectives of the GIS Society, there's a lot of potential to do very interesting work and to contribute to make sure, whether there's a council or not, to make sure that we can continue to grow the geospatial industry, to make sure that we could influence government to develop geospatial data in a way that could be shared. So that even if there isn't a coordinating organization, government agencies can still move forward. There's a lot you can do together, that we can do together, and the UE is very happy to continue to contribute to that. And I would volunteer my support to help any government agency or agencies that are willing to get together to move forward. So, you know, we have an opportune time to move it forward. And just to wrap up by saying that the conditions are very good at this stage to move SDI forward. Whether we are working at the international level, the regional level, or the national level, we can move ahead. There are a lot of things we can do that makes it very exciting. And I think we can all join together and move it ahead. The key, and as Cecile said, collaboration is a key to progress. That if we sit in our corners and decide that we're not going to share anything, we're not going to give anything, we don't care about anybody else, it's not going to happen. And the key to progress really is to be able to start sharing. And because, especially as government agencies, you didn't pay for it. All of us did, as taxpayers. And as a national asset, it belongs to all of us. And therefore, we are all entitled to have access to it so that we can all benefit from it. So if you're in the private sector, the thing is, if you have that kind of data, you can create apps, you can create all kinds of services out of that. But when you do that, you create employment. Employees pay taxes. Government, therefore, benefits from giving away data that belongs to all of us. With that, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ramlal. I know we have been sitting for quite a while and we've kind of gone over time, but I still want to just allow a few moments for two questions. Okay, I say two questions. Either to Dr. Ramlal or to Ms. Blake, if you have any questions or comments you just want to make. If you have two persons who want to do that, we have a microphone and anybody? Okay. All right, so you are, I guess, want to get up and move. All right, so thank you very much again to Ms. Blake and Dr. Ramlal for sharing this information with us. At this time, we will have a break. Yes, let me just say, we like you to exit. It's at the back of the auditorium. To exit through. Sorry. Okay. Right.
I'm being troublesome.
Come to the microphone. There.
I know that oftentimes in sessions like this, people are afraid to talk.
Yes, people are usually afraid to talk. And is it that our presentations were so clear that you have no questions? Can I get a response? Because remember, it is us and you, you know, it's not just us here talking. Because part of it is the interactions that we need to have. Or you prefer to talk to us offline, what you prefer. There are no questions, everything was clear. You're not responding, why? I'm between you and coffee break. Yes. I have a question for you. How is that? You'll accept the question? Sure? I'm going to put Dr. Ramlal on the spot. He's always telling me that I put him on the spot. He says, yes, I do. He spoke about his wonderful plan, his best practice, the thing that is becoming a best practice. Have any of you heard about it before, or was it the first time? Huh? First time? You have heard about it before? You have seen it? You have seen it? Well, what you think about that? I'm really putting him on the spot, you know. But what you think about that? You have a local document that is prepared in Trinidad. That is for the people of Trinidad. And you have only heard about it, but somebody in the global arena is seeing it, and you have not seen it. How you feel about that? You think that is good? All right. And I think you need to talk to him.
I will respond by saying that the reason it wasn't available before was that I only recently got approval from Cabinet to share it. You know, some of these documents of Cabinet. And they always tell you, well, look, you can't share it without permission. So I actually have it. If anyone is interested, maybe I can post it on our website at UE, or post it, or share it with the GIS Society, and they can send it out to you. I'd be very pleased to share it with everyone and anyone who wants any documentation from the NSDI Council. These things, as I said, belong to all of us, and I'm happy to share it. So please, just let me know, and I will share it with you.